All right, good morning.
Am I live?
Oh, yeah.
Good morning.
Good morning.
That's a little better. You know, the worship leader had her songs all picked out, God spoken to her, and already told the team, and then Friday evening, God told me she needs to sing that song for this morning, and I know there's a few people who needed to hear that this morning, and so if you were one of those who needed to hear that this morning, thank God for that. He's the one who changed that up Friday night, and I'm just so thankful that we serve a God who still talks to us. You know what I mean? And not only does God talk to us, but God delivers us. Maybe you didn't hear me this morning. Not only does God talk to us, but God delivers us.
Yeah.
Maybe you didn't hear me this morning. Not only does God talk to us, but God delivers us.
Amen.
This is a sermon that is going to be exciting, I think, I hope, I pray. And I want your feedback. I want to know that you guys are awake this morning. I want to know that God's touching your hearts and touching your minds. And I want to know that God is speaking to you today. And do you realize when you say amen or praise the Lord, that lets me know that I'm in the right direction. I'm in God's will and God is speaking to you. You see, because if God's not speaking to you, I need to go sit down. I'm not doing my job today. So it needs to be you guys getting involved in worship service and letting God speak to your hearts through the words that He gives me. So get involved in worship service. Let God know you're listening to His voice this morning.
Amen.
All right, this morning we're going to look at a Psalm of David. And I thank my brother and a man I just respect and love dearly for sharing this Psalm Wednesday night in deacons meeting for the inspiration God gave me, Brother Joe. God showed me through him reading that Psalm 40 that this is what I was supposed to preach this week. And this is the psalm that David wrote, King David. And David was a man after God's own heart. You need to understand that this morning. He was a warrior. He was a godly man. He was a king. He was a boy who was in the field as a shepherd. And he went from the shepherd in the field to the king of the castle. I don't know, maybe you don't realize that God can do that for you. Let me repeat that. David went from a boy in the field as a shepherd to the king in the castle.
Amen.
Amen.
That's a little better. You guys better get woken up today. You see, God is the God who can take you from the field as a boy, the youngest of siblings, who's a nothing, who's a runt, who's in the field as a shepherd. He can put you in the castle as a king. It doesn't matter what's going on in your life right now. It doesn't matter how you screwed up this week. It does not matter to God that last week you said something you shouldn't have said, that you did something you shouldn't have done, because I serve a king who is the great deliverer.
Amen.
He is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and He is the one who is on the throne, and it don't matter what you've done. He can take you from the field, and He can put you in the castle.
Yeah.
Pray for my voice. It's going to be one of them days. But see, David was a man of intense trials. You see, when you serve God, you're going to face trials. It's not easy. He faced intense trials his whole life. Tribulations that wouldn't stop. Sometimes he brought those on himself. Maybe I'm speaking to you today. Maybe you brought on some of those trials in your life by stupid decisions. But guess what? God's a great deliverer.
Amen.
You see, when you read the commentaries about Psalm 40, they don't know what David was going through when he wrote this. They're not sure. And to be quite honest with you, it don't matter. It don't matter. What matters is that David gave us some truth that applies in 2017 just like it did in 2000 B.C.
Amen.
Because God's Word is everlasting. Maybe you're facing hard times right now. Maybe you've been facing hard times for a while. Maybe you're about to face hard times. Well, I want you to know that if you know Jesus Christ, you know a great deliverer. He can deliver you from whatever trials, tribulations, troubles, whatever is in your way. That is the deliverer we serve. Let us read Psalm 40. If you're able, please stand for the reading of God's Word. I have a feeling this jacket ain't going to last very long. Psalm 40 says this, I waited patiently for the Lord, and He inclined to me and heard my cry. He brought me up out of the pit of destruction, out of the miry clay, and He set my feet upon a rock, making my footsteps firm. He put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many will see and fear and will trust in the Lord. How blessed is the man who has made the Lord his trust and has not turned to the proud, nor to those who lapse into falsehood. Many, O Lord, my God, are the wonders which you have done. Can I get an amen on that?
Amen.
And your thoughts toward us. There is none to compare with you. If I would declare and speak of them, they would be too numerous to count. Sacrifice and meal offering you have not desired. My ears you have opened. Burnt offering and sin offering you have not required. Then I said, behold, I come in. In the scroll of the book it is written of me, I delight to do your will. Oh my God, your law is written within my heart. I have proclaimed glad tidings of righteousness in the great congregation. Behold, I will not restrain my lips, O Lord, you know. I have not hidden your righteousness within my heart. I have spoken of your faithfulness and your salvation. I have not concealed your loving kindness and your truth from the great congregation. You, O Lord, will not withhold your compassion from me. Your loving kindness and your truth will continually preserve me. For evils beyond number have surrounded me. Let me read that again. For evils beyond number have surrounded me. My iniquities, that's my sin, have overtaken me so that I am not able to see. They are more numerous than the hairs of my head, and the heart has failed me. Be pleased, O Lord, to deliver me. Make haste, O Lord, to help me. Let those be ashamed and humiliated together who seek my life to destroy it. Let those be turned back and dishonored who delight in my hurt. Let those be appalled because of their shame who say to me, aha, aha. Let all who seek you rejoice and be glad in you. Let those who love your salvation say continually, the Lord be magnified. Since I am afflicted and needy, let the Lord be mindful of me. You are my help and my deliverer. Do not delay, oh my God.
Amen.
Amen. May God add His blessing and reading hearing of His word. You may be seated. So let's look at this scripture this morning. I'm not going to go 1 through 17 straight down the line sequentially. What I'm going to do today is I'm going to break them up into a couple different categories for you. I'm going to lump some scriptures together so you can see how all of this fits together. And so the first thing we're going to look at today is the problem. Say it with me, the problem.
The problem.
All right, so we're going to look at the problem today. And the first problem David tells us about is in verse 6. Okay? He says, sacrifice and meal offering you have not desired. My ears you have opened. Burnt offering and sin offering you have not required. In the Old Testament, here's what you need to understand. The way to God was through burnt and sin offerings. In the Old Testament, when David was writing this, if you wanted to go to God, you had to go to a priest who then had to put a burnt offering or a sin offering on your behalf. You couldn't go directly to God, and so that's a problem. Because today, you have the opportunity to go to God's throne of grace through the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You don't need to use me. You don't need to use Pastor Scott. You don't need to use a deacon. You don't need to use a priest in a Catholic church. You have the opportunity to go to God's throne on your own through the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
In the Old Testament, they couldn't do that. David says, but God, you don't require sin offering or burnt offering. That went against what they were saying. You see, that was a problem. They had to wait on someone else to go to God for their behalf. And see, he would do this because he was a man after God's own heart, but he still felt empty. He did the things God was requiring, but felt empty. He says, there should be more. There should be more than what I've been doing. You see, verses 6 through 10 are a prophecy for the coming of Christ. You see, if you're sitting here today, are you sitting here today?
Yes.
All right, cool. You're awake. If you're sitting here today then you were told about Christ. You see, David didn't get to see Jesus come. We're living 2,000 years past when Jesus came to this earth. 2017, according to some people. But you see, you have the opportunity to know this Jesus David wanted to know. You have an opportunity. Maybe you're sitting there and you've heard the name of Jesus in your life, but you've never known Him because you've never accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior. You never have made a personal decision to know Jesus Christ. Well, if you have not, today is the day of salvation, is what Scripture says. Behold, today is the day of salvation. Jesus says, I went and died for you so you can have salvation. Amen. You see, David wanted it, but he couldn't have it because he was prophesying about what was going to come. You see, the problem that David had and all the other Jews had was performing gods to please him, or performing sacrifices to please God, and they were left empty. When you're working to please God, you're going to be left empty. If you're working for your salvation, if the only reason you're working is to try to get on God's good side, you're going to feel left empty. You see, because God wants us to work out of a love for people. He doesn't want us to work to try to win His approval. He wants us to work because He wants us to love people. Is loving people easy? No. No. I'm a people, and I know I'm not easy to love. Amen. Stop. I knew there would be one. You see, here's the difference that I'm talking about today. If you're working to earn your salvation, you're working to do works, and you're going to come up empty.
That's right.
You see, here's the problem. You say, okay, God, I'm going to do this because you tell me to earn my salvation. You do that. Then God says, do this. And you're like, well, God, I did that yesterday. And so then you do that, and then God says, I want you to do something else. So you do that, and then God says, I want you to do something else. And you will never know that you are saved. You will never know that God has saved your soul. You see, we have a God who will save your soul and let you know that you're saved. He will let you know without an uncertain doubt that you've been saved. He doesn't want you to go through life wondering, am I going to make it to heaven? Have I done enough? Am I good enough? You see, those doubts and fears, those come from Satan. He wants you to question everything you're doing for Christ. When Christ says, come give your life to me, I'm going to transform you. And then you're going to work because you love people. That's what He wants. It's that simple. You see, the next problem David tells us about is in verse 12. And he says this, for evils beyond number have surrounded me. My iniquities have overtaken me so that I am not able to see. They are more numerous than the hairs on my head, and my heart has failed me. Anybody ever been in that situation before? Anybody ever been there besides me?
Yeah.
The first part is that evils beyond number have surrounded him. I have told you this before, and I will continue to tell you this. The more you serve Christ, the more Satan is going to attack you. The more he is going to bring his demons to try to squash you, to discourage you, and try to tear you down. He will try to stop you, but the rewards that Christ gives you when you serve him overtake all of the evil that Satan brings your way. You see, David understood this. Evils beyond number have surrounded me. He says, there's so much evil around me, I can't even tell you how much. I've lived it. I'm still living it. Satan will not stop. You know why? Because he doesn't want to see this people like you sitting at Sunrise Baptist Church. He doesn't want to see Sunrise Baptist Church transform lives. And he wants to stop us. And you know the thing is, Satan will use people to tear you down.
Yes.
Satan will use his minions to tear you down. When someone shows up and says, well, why are you going to church? You're always going to church. Why are you doing that? Say, because I love God and I love people.
Amen.
If you're going to be negative, just stop. I don't want to hear it.
Amen.
I was going to say, tell them shut up. Probably don't do that. When people are negative like that, when you're serving Christ, that's Satan. But you say, wait a minute, it's a Christian. You know what? We've all been used by Satan after we've been saved.
Amen.
We've all sinned. Amen?
Amen.
I think we need to say that a little louder. We have all sinned. Amen?
Amen?
We have all been used by Satan. And so just because it's a Christian doesn't mean it's a good thing. Okay? You got to have discernment. And that's where the Holy Spirit comes in. And so evils have surrounded him. The second part of this problem is that sin has overtaken him, so he can't even see anymore. Are you living in sin today? Let me answer it for you. If you're not a Christian, you never called on the name of Christ to save you from your sins, the answer to this is unequivocally yes, you're living in sin. You are not saved. And you're living in sin. If you've never been saved, you are living in sin. That means that your life is one big sin. If you are a Christian this morning, only you and God can answer if you're living in sin. It might be that secret sin that no one else knows about. Or it might be open, blatant sin and you just don't care. But see, even King David, a man after God's own heart, had fallen in the traps of the devil and was living in sin. His own sin had overtaken him, so he couldn't see anymore. His own sin. So that means that every single one of us who claim the name of Christ can fall into the trap of the devil. But there's hope. Hang on, there's hope. The third part of this is that it says his heart has failed him. Do you ever feel like you just want to give up? Do you ever feel like you just want to say, you know what, I'm done. I am absolutely done. Carl, stop. I am absolutely done with what is going on. Have you ever felt that way? Your heart is about to fail. You feel like I can't go on anymore. Am I the only one who's felt that way? We all have at some point, right? It's just trouble is so bad, evils are so bad, sin is so bad. We just want to quit. That's where King David was. That's where King David was. He was about ready to just say, I'm done. I can't go on. I just want to give up. You see, any pastor who's truly living for Christ and making a difference, they're going to feel this. You know, people put on Facebook, pray for your pastor, their load gets heavy. You have no clue. You have no clue what pastors have to deal with. Pray for us. Pray for ministry leaders, the leaders of boards and committees, ministry areas, because they got to deal with a lot of stuff that you guys don't see. Anybody in church leadership is going to be, at some point or another, feel like, you know what, I'm done. I'm cashing out. I'm done. And even King David felt this way. But here's the solution. There is a solution. Isn't that cool? Now that we know what the problem is, we've seen the problem, we can see what the solution is. The first part of the solution is in verse 1. And I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined to me and heard my cry. This is something we don't like to do. You see, King David realized, I need to wait patiently on the Lord. Because what do we want? We want it right now, right? We want God to step in and make everything right now. Okay, God, you convicted me. I've confessed. I've asked forgiveness. Now make it right. Well, sometimes it takes a little bit of time for God to make things right.
Amen.
You know, it's one of those things that I teach my kids. There's consequences to our choices. You can ask them. There's consequences to our choices, and sometimes those consequences last a long time. God will make things right, but we got to wait patiently on the Lord. And when we can just run to Burger King or Taco Bell or put something in the microwave, we don't like waiting patiently, do we? We don't. But you see, God's teaching you something. When He's making you wait, it's because He has something for you to learn. He has something to teach you. Are you teachable? Are you teachable? In other words, are you listening to God? This is a hard one, waiting on the Lord, waiting patiently. The next part of the solution is verses 7 through 10. And this is the prophecy of Jesus. And remember, this is the prophecy of Jesus. And so we need to, as we read this, we need to realize that King David, that God had spoken to King David that the solution to our problems is Jesus. There's no other solution except Jesus. He is the only one who can fix what ails you. He is the only one who can heal the hurt you have. He's the only one that can mend that broken relationship. He is the only one that can take care of your needs. King Jesus. Verse 7 says this. Then I said, behold, I come in the scroll of the book, it is written of me. He's talking about Jesus. In the scrolls of eternity, the books of eternity, God had already spoken of King Jesus.
Amen.
Before eternity even started, God had spoken about Jesus. He knew that you and me were going to need a Savior. He knew that we would never be able to keep the law. He knew that we were going to mess up. He knew that we were going to need a Savior. And so it was written before time. Verse 8 tells us this. I delight to do your will, O my God. Your law is written within my heart. This is two parts here in verse 8. The prophecy of Jesus being happy to do the Father's will, to die on the cross. You see, I've been talking about you needing to know Jesus if you're not saved. Well, how? Through Jesus dying on the cross. You see, Jesus was happy to pay the price for you. He was happy to willingly do God's will and die on the cross. He wanted to do it for you. Then David makes it personal by saying, he is delighted, he is happy to do God's will. Are you happy to do God's will? Are you happy to do the hard things that God asks you to do? Are you happy to read God's word, to pray, to get more involved, to be sold out? Are you happy to listen to instruction? Are you happy to be humble? Are you happy to serve, to give when it hurts? See, these are all things God requires. David was happy to do God's will. And so part of the solution is for you to quit moaning and groaning when God tells you to do something. Here we go. I got to do it again. I got to go to church. I got to go do this. I got to go do that. You know what? Turn that frown upside down and get happy. Get happy that God wants to use you. David delighted to do God's will. He was happy to serve. So why are we not? We see this as pain. Verses 9 through 10 says this. I have proclaimed glad tidings of righteousness in the great congregation. Behold, I will not restrain my lips, O Lord, you know. I have not hidden your righteousness within my heart. I have spoken of your faithfulness and your salvation. I have not concealed your loving kindness and your truth from the great congregation. Wow. Do you ever wonder why we stand up and do praises? Because we want to give you the opportunity to do what David did right there. In front of the congregation, proclaim God's goodness. You see, because if you were honest, you would see God doing something in your life. And if we are not willing and we are not able to stand up before professing believers and say God is good, here's what He's doing, how are we going to do that to unbelievers? How are we going to stand up to our neighbor and say, here's what Jesus is doing for me? The odds are, most likely we're not going to. And so we want to give the opportunity, just like David did in front of the whole congregation, for you to stand up and say, here's what God is doing. And that's why we do praise time. So we can show the faithfulness of God. You need to help build God's kingdom. your oikos, your extended family? Have you spoken of God's righteousness to your family, to His faithfulness, to His loving kindness? Have you spoken of God's truth to your family? Only you and God can answer that. Only you and God can answer if you're witnessing to your oikos, if you're telling them about Jesus. Because King David said, this is part of the solution. I'm going to tell everybody about what God's doing. I'm going to tell everybody. And if you can't tell your family and friends, how are you going to tell a stranger when God tells you to witness to him? So you need to be witnessing just like King David did. And what you'll find is the more you witness for Christ, the easier it gets. The more fulfilling it is. And I promise you, if you've never led someone to salvation the first time you do, you'll want to do it all the time. It is the biggest high you've ever been on. You can take heroin and alcohol and all these other things, they compare to nothing compared to leading someone to salvation.
Amen.
When you know that someone's going to heaven because of you, there's nothing in this world that compares. Alright, so let's look at the great deliverer now. In verse 2, we see the great deliverer in action. He brought me up out of the pit of destruction, out of the miry clay, and he set my feet upon the rock, making my footsteps firm. Wow. Here's the cool thing. He was in the pits of despair. David was in the pits of destruction. You see movies where someone's in quicksand? What do? They just sink, don't they? That's how David felt. Maybe you felt that way with something going on in your life. You just feel like there's no way out. You're up to here in quicksand and you just keep sinking and you can barely breathe. You're in the muck and the mire and you're in the mud and it's getting too much and it's about to overtake you. And you say, what do I do? God, where do I go from here? I can't get out of this. What do I do? You know what I'm reminded of? Anybody want to know? Oh, thank you. See, I told you I want you to interact this morning, didn't I? Here's what I'm reminded of. Anybody ever heard of a prophet named Elisha in the Old Testament? Elisha was witnessing to somebody. He had his partner beside him, and they were in a canyon, and they were surrounded by the enemy. The enemy was all around them, and they were about to be overtaken. And all of a sudden, the friend says, Elisha, what are we going to do? We're going to die. We are surrounded by the armies. And he said, okay, God, show him what you got. And God opened the eyes of his friend. And guess what was around? An invisible army of angels. I'm reminded of Jonah when he was in the belly of that big whale. Have you ever heard the story where Jonah was at the bottom of the ocean in that big fish's belly? He had nowhere to go but to God. And then the whale spit him out just like he said he would. I'm reminded of Elijah when he went to the widow's servant. He went to the widow and he said, your son is dead, but I can bring him to life. And so, what's he do? Through the power of God, he brings him to life. And someone please pray for my throat. He brings him to life. Someone pray. Come on. And he brings him to life and he says, all right, here's your son. He's alive. He brought him to life. Do you understand what I'm telling you today? I am reminded of when Jesus brought Lazarus back from the dead. Maybe you're not hearing me today. I'm reminded of when Jesus brought Lazarus back from the dead.
Amen.
I'm reminded of when Peter was walking up to the temple gates and he was going in to witness about Jesus. And there was a lame man sitting outside the temple gates. He was lame. He hadn't walked his entire life. And the man says, can I have money? He says, I don't have money, but what I have, get up and walk. And he gets up and walks. I'm reminded of when Jesus says, I want you to hear again. And the deaf is able to hear. I'm reminded of when Jesus says, you can't speak. Speak now. And the man's able to speak. I'm reminded of when Jesus takes the blind man and he makes him able to see again. I'm reminded of when Jesus brought me to life.
Amen. Amen.
I'm reminded that we serve a great deliverer. When David was in the muck and the mire, when he was in the pit and he had nowhere to go, he goes to God.
Amen.
What are you living through? What are you going through that there seems no way out? that it seems like all hell has broken loose against you, that Satan has just come and opened the gates of hell against you. Mm-hmm. The only place you've got is Jesus Christ. That's the only place. Because we serve a great deliverer. In verses 13 through 17, he goes on and he says, "Be pleased, O Lord, to deliver me." Oh man. Has anyone ever prayed that prayer? God, be pleased to deliver me. Make haste, O Lord, to help me. Make it quick, God. Have you been there before? God, make it quick. Let those be ashamed and humiliated together who seek my life to destroy it. He's praying against his enemies, that those who seek to destroy it, that God would make them humiliated, that God would say, "No more! You are not going after my servant anymore. Enough is enough. This child is mine, and Satan and your demons, you have nothing against my child."
Amen.
Deliver me, O God. Make haste and make humiliated my enemies. Ooh. Man, that's exciting stuff. Let those be appalled because of their shame who say to me, "Aha, aha." Let all who seek you rejoice and be glad in you. Let those who love your salvation say continually, "The Lord be magnified." Since I am afflicted and needy, let the Lord be mindful of me. You are my help and my deliverer. Do not delay. Oh my God. Wow. Where do we turn for help? We turn to stupid social media. We turn to our past, things that have tripped us up. We turn to other relationships that we shouldn't be turning to. We turn to everything this world has to offer but Jesus Christ.
That's right.
David said, "Oh Lord, I turn to you." Where do you turn in the time of trouble? Where do you turn when things aren't going so well? Where do you turn? You see, King David called him the great deliverer. That's my God. That's my God, the great deliverer. He's seen me through things that is unimaginable. He's seen you through things that are unimaginable. Because he is the great deliverer. He is the God who is still sitting on the throne. And that leaves us this morning with a blessing. When you turn to God, it leaves us with a blessing. In verses 3 through 5, he put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many will see and fear and will trust in the Lord. How blessed is the man who has made the Lord his trust and has not turned to the proud nor to those who lapse into falsehood. Many, O Lord, my God, are the wonders which you have done and your thoughts toward us. There is none to compare with you. If I would declare and speak of them, they would be too numerous to count. After the great deliverer has showed up in your life and he has delivered you and he delivered David from evil, this is what David said. David praised God. Why don't we? Why don't we praise God like he deserves? Man, we'll praise a football team, we'll talk about them for hours. We'll praise a basketball team, we'll talk about them for hours. But man, when God does something amazing, we don't say a word to anybody. Why? Why are we so scared to praise God? David wasn't. He praised God when God showed up. And that's true worship, my friends. That is true worship. When you praise God for who he is. When you praise God. If God has ever delivered you from evil, why would you not want to show up and sing as loud as you can on a Sunday morning? If God has provided for you financially when you didn't know how you were going to make it, why would you not show up and say, "Praise God, he took care of me this week"? You don't got to give details. You don't got to share all your business. That's not what I'm saying. But what I'm saying is, why do we not show up and sing as loud as we can and just say, "You know what? God took care of me this week. Praise God." Why do we not share and encourage other people? We need to start being the people who praise Him in everything. Notice that David says, "How blessed is the man that made his trust in the Lord." If you're a man or woman today who trusts in the Lord, you're blessed.
Amen.
You are blessed beyond measure. And you see, the thing is about this, is this is a song we sing. Can you imagine singing that? This is a song that David was singing. So let me ask you something this morning. Are you a man or woman who believes in Christ? Are you a man or woman who's put your trust in the Lord? Are you a man or woman who's been saved? If you're not, it's not too late. You're sitting here today. There's three steps to salvation. The ABCs. Admit you're a sinner. Believe on Christ. And the third one is to choose to follow Him. You admit you're a sinner. You believe on Christ. And you choose to follow Him. That means turning from the way you've been living and turning to Christ. If you're not a believer today, it's not too late. We're going to open up this altar here in a minute. If you've never been saved, God's been speaking to you today. God's been saying something to you. He's been saying that you're not right. You've been faking it for too long. It's time to make it right. Come grab me and we'll pray together and we'll ask Christ to save you from your sins and to make you right with Him. Or maybe you're a believer and you haven't been sold out. You haven't been witnessing to your family, your oikos. Maybe you've been living in sin like David was. It's time you come up here and you confess that to God and make it right. If you need me, grab me, we'll pray together. If you just want to pray by yourself, you can do that as well. Let's pray now. God in heaven, I do love you, I do praise you, and I do thank you, God, for this opportunity to spread your message. I pray it sticks in the hearts and minds of these people. God, if there's anybody that doesn't know you as Lord and Savior, I pray today is the day of salvation. And I pray, God, for any believers who have never chosen to live sold out, who don't witness, who grumble and complain when you tell them to serve, that they'll come up here and they'll make it right with you, God. Whatever the need is, I know you'll meet them at this altar. And we thank you in the powerful name of Jesus, our great deliverer. Amen.